we're good to go.
Hello. Hi, guys. we're back.
We're back.
We keep doing it.
Today's a very sad day. We are pouring one out for Anthony Bourdain, or as he was affectionately known to his friends.
Tony.
Tony, we will miss you so much.
No, but really, though. I woke up this morning around 8 a.m. to like a Hollywood Reporter notification, which I get on my phone.
Yeah.
And then immediately remembered 2 days ago when me and you were talking mad shit on him on the train.
Yeah, well, I'm in a lot of hot water for that, which I'll come around to a little bit later. But Anthony Bourdain was, you know, a class act, a great showman, a very sexy looking man who could get it in hell.
Only kind of got better looking.
Yeah.
Was gorgeous when he was young.
Yeah.
Bad boy chef.
Yeah.
And just became more like silvery and fine.
A sexy silver fox. My mother used to say that anybody who survives a heroin addiction lives forever. And that's like certainly the case with like, you know, someone like
that. It has certain preservational qualities. Yeah.
Or who else did heroin? Did Iggy Pop do heroin? Probably. Yeah. Like they get like very skinny and sinewy. I guess Anthony Bourdain hanged himself earlier today, which is really like the most horrific way to go. Like no jokes, no lulls, no hot takes.
As did Kate Spade a couple days ago
with her own scarf. Yeah. And there's a new report from federal health officials that suicide rates in America are up 30% from 1999 to 2015. The findings were reported by NBC News, and they come from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And they also found that half of the people who successfully died by suicide did not have diagnosed mental health conditions. So
it didn't seem. I mean, I'm skeptical about that.
Me too.
Just because mental health is already something that's so hard to.
Yeah, like this is, it's like the double kind of like dual issue that statistics are kind of wobbly and mental health designations are wobbly, but basically people who hadn't been through the mental health ringer.
Yeah, the findings that they cited sort of pointed to other things like relationship problems, substance misuse, physical health problems, job or financial problems.
Yeah.
Which all are things that could, you know, contribute to.
Yeah, conceivably, yeah. And there is also, I guess they also found that middle-aged adults were particularly at risk with the highest growth in suicide rates. And I think a lot of this has to do with the kind of resounding theme of this podcast, like the drudgery and toil of life under neoliberalism. But, you know, you have to wonder, like Anthony Bourdain and Kate Spade were like very well-off individuals, and even they weren't immune to suicidal ideation. But I think like the news of the loss of Bourdain is like a really hard pill to swallow for me, at least, because, you know, I tweeted this afternoon that Bourdain had a lot of parallels with the leftist music and culture critic Mark Fisher, who committed suicide last year. And, you know, he was a similarly beloved, if more like mass market figure. And I think, you know, for me at least, he was like a beacon of hope because he navigated the complexities of modern life with kind of a sensitivity and empathy and humanity that's like lost in the general culture at large.
Right.
And also like, you know, it was a setback for what it spells for his fan base, which is kind of a foreclosing of hope, or what Mark Fisher described in really beautiful terms as like the slow cancellation of the future. Which is like very depressing, like in the face of the kind of the rapid pace of late capitalism, basically.
But you, because a couple of days ago you had a tweet about Anthony Bourdain.
Yeah, I did. I had a tweet. A lot of people were mad at me today on Twitter because I had a tweet a couple of days ago, believe it or not. This is the second time that I've like criticized somebody on Twitter and then they've died.
Who else?
It's always a beloved figure.
Who else?
Carrie Fisher. It's really shitty. I was like sort of like dumping on Carrie Fisher, and then, you know, 2 days later she was dead. Yeah, a couple of days ago
criticized.
I'm a horrible harpy witch, a harbinger of death and destruction. Mm-hmm. Bottomless pit of despair and decay. But a lot of people
on
Twitter,
you never say anything bad about me.
Hang yourself with like a bralette or some panties. No, so a lot of people were mad at me on Twitter because a couple of days ago I criticized Bourdain for the inconsistency of his positive position on women's issues in the wake of Me Too compared to his performative denial of animal suffering, which I realize now was possibly like a gesture of self-preservation because he was probably like a sensitive person who absorbed a lot of the horrors of the world. But I had just come off of watching this episode of Bourdain, the Borneo episode, where he spears a sobbing pig in a net and then goes on about how he like is remorseless and not
sad. Shall I read the tweet?
Yeah, if you want.
Anthony Bourdain thinks Vindictive Harpy, Rose McGowan, and washed up cornball Iggy Pop are cool, but socialism and veganism are whack because he's a perennial adolescent who confuses a performative lack of empathy for the transgressive gesture, which is a fair critique and can mutually exist with mourning the loss of someone you admire.
Yeah.
And I did unretweet it.
Yeah, I figured you would. Yeah, I figured. It's okay. No hard feelings, Dasha.
Just poor timing.
Yeah. But I mean, I think overall it was a fair critique. And the only reason I made that critique.
And one that he probably would have been, not to like speculate about the recently deceased, but I'm sure one that he would have been open to.
But it's like.
And Rose McGowan's behavior in light of his death with her like sobbing histrionic video also completely vindicated
me. Yeah, I felt vindicated. I mean, this is like a critique that like is not mutually exclusive of my sadness. A lot of people on Twitter are like, you were kind of trashing him.
Now
you're sad. And I'm like, well, no, I was always sad about Anthony Bourdain because he was like one of my favorite cultural figures. Mm-hmm. And I obviously cared about his politics because I admired his position at large and I admired his show. Like I wouldn't like I was telling the ladies earlier, I wouldn't give a shit if we were talking about like Dinesh D'Souza or Ben Shapiro or one of these retards who's not even worth our outrage, you know?
I think the only problem with that veganism and animal rights critique, which you know very well that I love animals.
Of course.
But I think Anthony Bourdain had this obsession with going into these communities, oftentimes marginalized communities, and not alienating through
cultural relativism.
He's not going to sit at a table and like push away like a roasted hog or any body part of an animal.
No.
Or
and that's also this like very chef-y ethos of like.
Well, that was one of the things that like somebody kind of was like, well, you know, you realize that a lot of being like a chef is incompatible with veganism. And I was like, it's not so much that he is kind of circumspect about the slaughter of animals in the industry. It's that he would, I think, like performatively relish in their slaughter on television because, once again, probably as a defense mechanism.
Yeah, I think he'd rather not alienate the community he was visiting.
Yeah, but I mean, that's one thing. That the second thing is like, you know, you don't have to gloat in it for the audience, which is like an Anglophone, like fairly privileged audience, I guess.
Yeah, and I mean, he's apologized profusely for perpetuating the bad boy, like kind of bro culinary stereotype,
which still prevails
absolutely
very much so to this day.
But I was, you know, I was really truly like outraged by the Rose McGowan tweet where she like posted a video of her sobbing and described how mad she was at Anthony for killing himself and then issued like a potboiler remark about suicide hotlines.
Well, and she also
the suicide hotline post like all over the feed is so cynical and makes me so
it's so disgusting.
Yeah. What I took issue with is that she calls it a temporary problem. And I think for people living within the shackles of mental illness their entire life, it's not a temporary problem. It never goes away. And so to like kind of act like a psychopath, I mean, I get it. She's very upset, but.
And very damaged.
Yeah. Yeah. Like we shouldn't downplay her own trauma, but,
she shouldn't have a platform.
She,
you know,
like an influential platform. Yeah.
Well, his girlfriend, wait, they're not married,
right? Asia Argento, yeah.
Yeah. She tweeted like a very tasteful, dignified little note out today.
Well, you know, she's a far more tasteful and dignified woman than Rose McGowan.
And she requested, like, you know, please respect your privacy and like silence.
Hours before his body was found, she did post.
I saw this.
On her Instagram story of picture of her wearing a t-shirt that said fuck everybody with a caption that said you know who you are.
Oh.
And then after he was found dead, she took it down.
Did she delete it?
Which caused people to speculate as to like some people think he was perhaps about to get Me Too'd.
Yeah, that sadly crossed my mind.
And so he sort of preemptively took his own life.
Okay. Jesus.
I've also heard that he was maybe murdered by
let's have it out Go on.
Another theory I heard was that Harvey Weinstein had him killed by the same Mossad agents he had following Rose McGowan. Because he was such a male ally that Weinstein couldn't risk having him on the loose. And the wildest take perhaps was from Alex Jones, friend of the pod, on our sister network InfoWars, posited that he was murdered by globalists because he was about to come out as a Trump supporter, or as Alex Jones put it, he was planning to do a Kanye West.
Wait, globalists meaning Jews?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Sorry that I had to clarify that. Bourdain was such a hard-boiled, dyed-in-the-wool liberal.
Yes.
That I couldn't ever imagine him jumping on the Trump train. Like, can you imagine?
No, clearly that's insane, and that is so sinister of Jones to even capitalize on this moment.
He's the type of guy who was so kind of invested in his own kind of reformed bad boy position that his Trump's vulgarity and like lack of decorum would have been completely off-putting to him.
Right. He was absolutely not about to do a Kanye West.
But like, I mean, can you imagine like you know, Anthony Bourdain calling a suicide hotline? Like, that's an obscene image. And I really resent you guys having the same haircut as this horrible histrionic
as McGowan.
Vicious succubus of
you
a woman.
You have a cuter Thank haircut. You.
Yeah.
You've got she just has sort of a straight up buzz.
Cut. Yeah. But I was like thinking like, you know, way to take a shared tragedy that we're all mourning because this is a very public figure and like somehow make it about yourself.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Alex Jones did also mention that he had met with Elon Musk in Morocco to discuss a big awakening that was happening.
Yeah. And I was thinking about like I had a little bit of a back and forth exchange with this guy, David Rudnick, who's like a graphic designer. It wasn't it was an amicable exchange, not an inflammatory one. But he had a good tweet today that said that basically we've created a world that only rewards people who can shut out their sensitivity and empathy, and that those who refuse to live by that standard do so at a tremendous risk to themselves. And I was thinking about how
David Foster Wallace
is
another example of someone who's profoundly in touch and empathetic and just couldn't sustain it.
And I think, you know, there's a type of person who sort of like absorbs all the horrors of the world and is kind of crippled by them in a way. And that applies to Fisher as well as to Bourdain. I was thinking about like Fisher, if you guys remember, had a really important, very controversial essay called Exiting the Vampire Castle. Where he like sort of implicated the toxic, self-defeating internecine warfare of the modern left for its failure to gain like a foothold in contemporary politics. And there was a good piece by Amber.
Was that his last essay? No.
No, I think it was one of the later ones.
He left Twitter after.
He left Twitter, yeah. But he was like completely crucified. And there's a good quote from Amber where she talks about how he infuriated much of the self-identified left by arguing that a shallow and noxious liberal identity critique delivered mostly on the internet was being used to undermine class politics and left discourse. And, you know, even though Fisher's point was delivered in the most compassionate and charitable language. He was still crucified for it, even to the point where after he died, people were toxic male bro, cishet bro, uh-huh. which of course contributed probably to his suicide. Like one of the things that I heard was that basically, because I asked my friend who was like a former student of Fisher's, I asked him like, well, how did you feel about him killing himself when he left behind like a wife and a kid?
Yeah.
And then it turned out, I've heard that basically his wife and kid were being so threatened in their home by these like,
oh my God,
horrible people that his calculation was almost like, if I kill myself, I would protect them or whatever.
August Ames was another Twitter induced suicide.
Who was that?
She was a porn star who didn't want to do a scene with a porn actor who also did gay porn, due to like a pretty informed, reasonable view that like of HIV transmission rates and stuff.
When did this take place?
This was in December.
Oh.
She tweeted, and she tweeted about it and was like, sort of to let other actresses know, like to be informed that this was like, a practice that they should be aware of. And then, people on Twitter just jumped down her throat, calling her like a homophobe and stuff. And I'm sure she like suffered from depression, et cetera, but she took her own life after like,
right.
Yeah, her mentions were just a goddamn mess, probably.
Yes. Yeah, I'm sure there's a lot, like, I think, like, social media and, like, the constant sensory overload of, like, being on the internet at all times, like, really contributes, it really intensifies people's pre-existing mental health conditions. And, like...
Oh, absolutely.
You know, David and I were talking about this on Twitter very briefly, and he was saying that, incidents like these remind you that people who are like fighting the good fight should not be left to fight alone. And, I appreciate his viewpoint, but my feeling is also that people who, speak truth to power and are like champions of the truth basically are solitary creatures because they're ahead of their time, and by the time that,
and real truth to power, not just like liberal platitudes that are co-signed by
and
the status quo,
by the time everybody else catches up to them, it's already too late. Like and it's always like, they always say like celebrity deaths come in three.
Mm-hmm.
We're just like biding our time
for the third.
But we had already planned to talk about suicide as a topic today. We were going to record today, and it's shocking and upsetting that Bourdain died today. And I was also like, just to go back to the question of class politics real quick. Sorry. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing any funny hot takes or anything like that today. I'm like really upset. But like, I think like his shows, like even Bourdain's like programming represented this kind of like old school style of television programming.
No reservation.
Yeah. But like all TV now, like the entertainment landscape is like people fucking and sucking in night vision, right. Or people offering their like half baked and racially inflammatory hot takes, or people like agreeing to fight each other in like a no holds barred, zero sum rat race of like extremely low stakes competition, like you win $10,000. And his shows were really like, in a sense, like somebody said it really well, I forgot who, but they were like basically the old school mold of television. They were equally edifying, like educational and accessible to a mass audience,
right.
And they made sense of like,
they were so watchable.
Yeah.
A lot of people have been passing these quotes around, but like him browbeating on Henry Kissinger regarding Cambodia. And it's like, it's amazing that you were able to do that at length on
TV, a popular TV show. But it reminds me of kind of it's like a throwback to the heyday of public programming, like of the ilk of BBC or PBS, when there was only three channels that offered equally decent options, and not like an endless array of equally bad alternatives.
Soviet.
Well, I mean, it is. But
he even ripped in that Kissinger quote. he's ripping on Charlie Rose with PBS.
Yeah.
You know, it's like he was able to be uncensored a little bit more also.
Yeah. I'm curious. I mean, I'm curious as to why that is. Like, why do you think that is?
I don't know. Tattoos. Just like, he was punk rock.
Yeah. He came, he built his career off of like this, confessional,
like bad boy, you know, image,
but in a, all, like on a foundation maybe of honesty and like integrity that he could have relinquished when he, you know, rose to some level of prominence but never really did.
Yeah, and I don't feel that he did. Like, I mean, I find some of his like liberal politics fairly infuriating as a person who's probably left of his
but you know what, he's like a corny Gen X in the most like benign way.
Yeah but I don't find them to be insincere, which they are for a lot of people, like John Oliver or like Trevor Noah, like these talking heads. And I think, like, I mean, the thing that struck me is that
he was nothing if not like earnest, if you know, even corny.
And he did a good job. And like, you know, like you watch like what's the famous one that's on now that I'm really gonna miss, the show,
it's like
Parts Unknown.
Yeah, on CNN.
And that's what I also call my pubic area. Sorry.
There you go.
Yeah, he was really hot. I really liked kind of observing his like leathery tattooed covered bodied. I don't like tattoos on men or women, generally speaking.
He only has a couple. He has like an Ouroboros.
Yeah, that somebody hammered in Borneo. He was like Angelina Jolie. He like went to kind of like this weird jungle enclave and whatever. Uh-huh. But like, no, I liked his tattoos. I thought they were like sexy.
Well, he has like the Sailor Jerry type tattoos too.
He does. I don't.
Yeah, but I mean, what I mean to say is that like, Anthony Bourdain, I think when I say like he's like a throwback to the old public style of television programming, he's also a person who was like implicitly in support of class politics, which is radical and cool and unforeseen now.
And part of that was, you know, it had to do with his like travels and his like openness, and it is sad. It's really sad.
Yeah. I mean, traveling so much to different locales probably like gives you a sense for the fact that like actually, like, you know, ethnically, culturally, racially, people are different, but they're more the same than they're different. And most of like society's ills come about due to classism, not any sort of like not like the folly of multiculturalism. Exactly. And I will say, like, you know, like you watch all these episodes and he has like varying levels of joyousness for experiencing different like cultural cuisines, but he really hated Russia.
Iceland he hated too.
Yeah.
He notoriously hates Switzerland as well.
Interesting. Well, though, I mean, I enjoy Russian food, but.
Me too. Hashtag me too.
Iceland and a lot of Swiss, I can get behind being pretty gross.
A lot of TV hosts hate Russia. Like, I watched, this is shameful to admit, but I watched Chelsea Handler's show. I don't even think it probably got canceled recently.
She's a fucking bitch.
I know, she's a bitch. But she went to Russia and she was such a twat the whole time.
What was Donny's problem with Russia?
I just think he really didn't like the food.
Donny, why do you not like us?
I don't know. He went. He had some political aversions as well.
I think, yeah, he was probably creeped out.
Well, his thing with Iceland was that it's so isolated that there's no way that a, like, a vibrant cuisine could
come about.
I mean, fermented shark is disgusting.
I've never had it, but the housewives, the Orange County housewives have it, and they all, like, kind of, like, ratchet up. It's, yeah, it seems disgusting.
I tried it when I was there. I'd
love to, you know, make a nice olivier for him. Yeah.
Olivier. Vinaigrette.
Did you guys?
Zakuski for Tony.
You know, maybe Dasha, when we ascend to heaven or hell or wherever we're going, we could be part of
Tony's harem.
Did you guys see the Hannah Moskowitz tweet where she said, can we veer away from the, wow, this one is hard rhetoric with regards to Bourdain? Think about what the implication is here, what you're saying about Kate Spade, what you're saying about women.
So retarded.
So who is Hannah Moskowitz person?
Who is this Hannah Moskowitz person? How dare she?
How can a Jew be so stupid?
I mean, it goes without saying that's a dumb ass take, but beyond that, it's like, because Kate, right, because Kate Spade is a woman.
I think plenty of people were talking about Kate Spade's suicide. It's just that she made handbags and this guy
was like a prominent cultural figure.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't know what Kate Spade looked like.
Yeah, until it's like she apples and took oranges. Her own
life. And
yeah.
Of course, it's still tragic.
Yeah, it's like she made luxury goods.
Yeah.
This is a different ballgame.
She was part of, a luxury dynasty that included David Spade, right? Wasn't he one of their
Her brother-in-law.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, but that's like so typical of like the current like lib femme rhetoric to like kind of deliberately mix metaphors and confuse terms and like make apples into oranges. I mean,
also she popped off with this one at 7:27 a.m. I wow. hadn't even seen
this is when the news the broke. News.
Yeah, it's just like
so. Yeah, who was in her feed already? Like, yeah, espousing the virtues of Bourdain.
Maybe sit on it for
Spade.
Half of a day.
Yeah, like, give Jesus. It a yeah. Let's see how it comes out in the wash.
That's another thing that like we, you know, we as women can't really critique. It, you know, it goes back to the Rose McGowan thing. There is a very overtly punitive, vindictive streak to liberal feminism that loses sight of kind of the main point of feminism, which is that it's an empathetic, class-based movement, right?
Yeah.
That aims to gain equality and justice for the most marginalized people. And it's just like a very bizarre take on the day that somebody, like a very, again, a beloved cultural figure dies to come with this like weird.
Yeah, it's like a
feminist.
Very classically short-sighted liberal feminist take.
Yeah, and I will say, you know, when Amy Winehouse died, there was no shortage of people. I mean, it wasn't suicide, but it might as well have been.
Sure.
I'm still very upset about Amy Winehouse. I know plenty of people who are. Because she was also
much
like
too soon.
Yeah. And she was also like a very when Carrie Fisher died, there's another woman who was like
very. How did Carrie Fisher die? Again?
I think she had a drug overdose. Okay. So again, but she was a very troubled person her whole life.
Yeah.
Very
kind of like and openly.
Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah.
I mean, I do believe in one's right to die.
Yes. Well, that's another thing that like we should. Like, talk about there's like this, you know, whole I guess Catholic idea that suicide is cowardly.
Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about that.
I mean, I grew up sort of Catholic and I didn't get that takeaway.
Well, it's like Christianity in general. I mean, most religions, I think, condemn suicide.
Yeah, but I was thinking about
on the
it.
Grounds that it's like squandering the gift of life that God
What's Judaism's
someone.
Take?
I wouldn't know. We're I'm not real Jewish
Jews.
Anymore.
None of us
I'm
are like real Jews. but I'm sure it's frowned upon. I mean, any Judeo-Christian religion.
Meg, I think you got to take to Google and hit that Judaism.
I don't think there. I would be very surprised if there was any Judeo-Christian faith which suicide was sanctioned.
I only know about the front end of life, which is that they believe life begins at first breath. So in the abortion debate, that's cited frequently.
At first anal.
But I've seen, I mean, beyond Rose McGowan, I've seen Val Kilmer release a statement sort of about how angry he was and how cowardly it was of Bourdain to take his own life. And with suicide, I think that, it's like the critique, right, is that it's selfish, is that it like, which it is, it deprives
the world
the
of your
world
great
of your,
presence
your presence.
Well, you know, there's a really
on an individual level, it's like, I think
like you can't, the one thing that was there's a really great quote from one of my favorite authors, Alberto Moravia, that all suicide is an act of spite, and I generally do believe that. And you know, if we want to get into the male versus female statistics, they are that men
succeed
more often than women.
Yeah,
because there is a school of thought that says that, you know, all these women who are basically threatening to commit suicide or going through the motions are basically doing it as a cry for help, whereas men genuinely want to take their lives. I don't know. I'm not going to get into that.
The statistical, the rise of suicide rates in the U.S. has also seen an increase in like firearm suicides, which have like an 80% success rate or something. It's one of the most efficient ways.
And that's probably mostly men, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And women tend to favor like drug overdoses.
Okay.
Which are, you know, like a nice dramatic gesture, but not...
They're harder to implement because you never know, like a handful of pills, you don't know if you're going to, you know.
How would you guys
do
it?
How would I do it? I'm a coward, so I would want to do it in the least painful way possible. I would probably just, you know, take my cat and go into the garage and like turn on the exhaust or whatever. I'm taking my daughter down with me.
The garage. Whatever. Your garage in Ridgewood.
I would like, I've thought about
her non-existent car.
Very, yeah.
I guess I'd have to go
that's
to
a very optimistic suicide ideation.
Well, you guys, this is why I can't
there.
Commit suicide as much as I like want to all the time, because I would have to go to my mother's house in New Jersey, and then she'd have to discover me, and that would be really fucking
you
dark.
Haven't ascended.
I just can't do it because I have a fucking dog to take care of now.
Well, you know, I've always said that pets
well,
are
you
collateral
write in the note,
against
you
suicide.
Say, Fran...
What's that?
In your note, you have to specify who takes care of the dog, and then
no one's going to take Fran. Fran's evil.
How would you do it?
I definitely wouldn't hang myself. That is so dark.
No.
That
is dark.
I don't even know how to tie a noose. Yeah. Honestly, I would probably drown.
You can't.
That's romantic, dog.
Yeah, I would get really fucked up and like walk into the sea or something. Or yeah, exactly. Or jump in front of a train.
Yeah, well,
because of the drama.
Yeah.
You sync up a really sick song in your headphones,
like
and then
The
you
Weeknd,
just,
The Hills, or Bruno Mars. What's the one with Cardi B? Whatever.
Ariana Grande,
Side to Side,
and then like, I just let my body fall onto the tracks.
Yeah, I was actually,
and then you get to ruin a bunch of people's day, which is really
totally
cool.
Like like the train system, the MTA system is already fucked up, and it's going to be like, you know, another hour before everybody, 3 hours before everybody gets
and
on.
And in my note, I'll make sure in my note that the MTA is to blame. Yeah.
The sad reality is no one is going to remember it the next day.
Right.
Because no one, everyone's evil and no one cares.
Well, yeah, I had a suicidal ideation when I was walking here today because I was at the intersection of like Nostrand and Lexington.
Nice.
And I was thinking about how like exhausting and miserable my life is. And I saw a New York City bus with the like a billboard on the front for the Museum of Sex. And I was like, this is how I want to go, mowed down by a Museum of Sex billboard.
Or like a one of those Google Street View cars that surveils and photographs neighborhoods.
I
just
feel
walk
like
in front of those.
You know, I feel like committing suicide is like no longer necessary in this day and age because we're all going to be like lined up and shot by like whatever tech lord.
It's only a matter of
like
time.
Elon Musk or whoever assumes
I'll see you
the
in a
presidency.
Ditch.
Yeah.
I had a sad thought that sort of made me, I guess the last time I was really suicidal, which wasn't that long ago, I sort of thought the best way to go would also be to leverage my death in some kind of like political, you know, gesture where I would either like try and assassinate, like figure out who I could actually assassinate that would maybe make the most impactful. I'm going to get like on a list now, but
yeah, that's okay. We're all on lists here.
Just like who the best like political figure would be for me to try and take out. And then
yeah, I would
just use my already mean. Yeah, exactly. Detonate the vest. It's some in a way that really counted.
And then you could be sort of like a romantic heroine.
You're
who's
a martyr.
Like wearing like a, you know, a cravat or whatever, a kerchief or a beret.
But thinking about David Foster Wallace recently, I had a moment where it dawned on me how much he would have like enjoyed maybe cerebrally like a Trump presidency.
Yeah.
And how unfortunate it is that he never
got to see it.
So that made me kind of that gave me pause to be like, you should try and stick it out because something really retarded is going to happen and like you're going to really want to find out what it is.
I know. Well, that's a great philosophy to have because that's like really the only thing that keeps me going. Like the fact that I have to like feed this cat and also the fact that something really cool and retarded might happen that I like might want to witness.
We could all die in like a nuclear war.
Yeah.
And that's, I don't want to miss out on that.
I'm afraid that will happen and I'll survive. Well, it definitely will survive because there's like reactors upstate that are bound to implode. And the nuclear like waste.
You think you'll survive?
Roll off would be like to hit where I live in Queens.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I kind of feel like I'll survive and then I have to like deal with radiation.
You'll just get really sick.
Yeah. You're just going to die slower.
Skin won't like burn off in some really badass way.
Yeah. I don't know. I have really terrible nightmares about like apocalyptic things that I frequently think are still real hours after they happen.
Oh, I've been having pettier and pettier dreams about like people blocking me on Twitter and like other kinds of doomsday scenarios like that.
Yeah.
Who in your recent memory besides Bourdain was the celebrity death that made you saddest?
I mean,
anyone?
Prince and Bowie.
You were bummed about.
I'm really dead inside.
I don't know. I don't get like crazy like on Twitter and I'm not on Twitter, but like Facebook and Instagram, like putting out tributes. But it just makes me feel a little funny. I also worked in a psychiatric hospital in college, and I worked on the adolescent floor. So I think I have a rough time with this subject matter,
with death in general, or suicide.
With suicide and
I
mental
love death
and mental chaos. Illness.
I'm obsessed with chaos.
but you know, working with 10-year-old schizophrenics was a very scarring experience for me.
Do you guys want to know something crazy?
What's up?
I've never really known anyone who's died.
Wait, really?
You're very lucky, Tasha.
Yeah. Three of my grandparents, but they're like
old.
In Belarus. Yeah. I didn't even really have relationships with them. I mean, I'm sad. I was sad about their deaths, but it wasn't like no one I've really ever been close to have considered like a dear friend has ever passed away.
But you have a small family, right?
Ish. Very small, yeah.
Yeah. See, I have a huge family. Like there was a point in time during my like middle school years and high school years where it was like every week I was going to a funeral of a family member.
Irish people.
Well, that's my dad's side, sure. But yeah.
No, I mean.
But that kind of makes me feel like I might be
you're going to be the tragic figure. Oh, the tragic waif.
How old are you? 27.
Oh. You got to do it this year. You know, it sucks because I don't want to encourage Dasha to commit suicide because we're running a very promising grift here together. We all need each other to survive, but you know, if you're gonna do it, you gotta.
Now's the time.
Yeah, I really like. I really kind of missed the suicide boat, just like I missed the birthright boat, and now I have to like really see it through to the horrible end. I will say the celebrity that I'm like so upset about still is George Michael.
Oh, yeah, that one too.
I love him because he was so sweet and sensitive.
Yeah, and cool and hot.
And Freddie Mercury.
Yeah, and had great style.
I was sad about.
Who?
About Freddie Mercury.
Marky Smith. Oh. He's like not even a celebrity, but he was the frontman of this band, The Fall.
Lil Peep.
Lil Peep, you know.
Someone's going to, I think the next one's 6ix9ine, but he's going to get murdered.
Oh, God. He's the worst.
But besides that, like none of celebrity deaths don't. When I remember when Lou Reed died, I had very recently moved to LA, and there was a bunch of girls in my house like crying, and I was like, "Do you all know that like Lou Reed? I mean, and I love Lou Reed. I'm like a Velvet Underground like super fan." And like the various solo careers of their members, but when he died, I was like, you guys know, like, Lou Reed wasn't, like, a really good person. Like, it's not, like...
Was he not? He seems like a guy that Anthony Bourdain would have been obsessed
exactly.
with.
Exactly. But he wasn't... No, he was, like, notoriously kind of, like, sociopathic.
Okay.
Or at least, like, in Please Kill Me, that's the impression you get in other, like, Velvet's
I think this is where, bios. Like, record heads get, like, blinded by...
Yeah,
music, and they think like it's like no, this person sucks.
Yeah, like yeah. Lou Reed is like probably like monstrous.
Well, yeah, no, but this is like all the people who were butthurt about me saying Iggy Pop was like a leathery cornhole or whatever. I'm just like, well, he seems like kind of a whack, shitty person who's like a seeker. Like I said, he's like the Jennifer Aniston of like pop music or rock music or whatever.
Same haircut.
I saw him in person at the documentary screening and oh, yeah. he was so short. It really threw me off.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's like people who still say like that stuff is rock and roll.
Yeah, exactly. And I think like Bourdain was probably of that
R.I.P.
ilk. Yeah.
R.I.P. Anthony Bourdain.
Yeah.
I hope he's rocking and rolling
in heaven.
In heaven right now.
I hope I can get to heaven one day so I can suck his dick.
Oh my God.
Sorry. That's fine. That's we all mourn in different ways, yeah. Meg.
It's fine.
That's okay to say.
Well,
wow, we just did an entire episode on suicide. Yeah. Jesus Christ. So just hang side note.
And this number for the suicide hotline is, just kidding.
1-800-RED-SCARE-TONY.
All right. This episode was recorded a little bit early for scheduling. So
if anyone else kills themselves before we post it, we didn't get to it.
Yeah, we're sorry.
And Anna's going to try and curb the shit talking someone else.
I won't say anything mean. I'm going to, you know, I'm actually going to go on Twitter right now and say something mean about Bono because I've had enough of him.
God, he's going to die, Anna. Like, that's literally going to happen.
Right. Any last words?
We'll see you in heaven, Tonya.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that was a good episode. It was very sad and mean.
Sad, and then it got... We'll close out with this.
Okay, Adam. I'll wait for you.
Sleight of hand and twist of fate. A bed of nails, she makes me wait. And I wait without you. With or without you. With or without you. Through the storm we reach the shore. You give it all, but I want more. And I'm waiting for you. With or without you.
Keep it a little lighter this time after our suicide episode. Yeah. This won't be posted for a couple days, but it is Father's Day. Happy Father's Day, Anna. And Leia is also here with us
back
again.
With us. Happy Father's Day, ladies. I want to say happy Father's Day to all the dads and the daddies out there.
Especially the daddies.
I'm wearing my...
Daddy's girl.
You are in honor of daddy. Yeah. So we did say that we were going to keep it light. So we're going to, you know, have some dad themed topics on the docket for you.
That's right. Sort of. I mean,
sort of.
We tried to link them cohesively, but a great Father's Day treat for me was to see Steve Bannon back on the news.
Yeah.
He did his first interview with ABC's Jonathan Carl since being ousted from the White House. And he is looking as dead-eyed and frightening as...
As decaying from as the inside, usual. As usual.
Like, pure evil. He was not wearing his... Maybe he was. I couldn't tell if he was wearing more than one shirt, as he is wont to do. But his hair was looking good. And he was doing a great old suck job on our Führer.
Yeah.
Donald Trump. Maybe trying to weasel his way back
win him back.
To...
into favor. I will say Steve Bannon does have a good head of hair for a man who looks completely like cadaverous otherwise.
He looks, yeah, like a reanimated corpse.
Yeah, he looks like if Mel Gibson in that movie Forever Young was not cryogenically frozen but just buried and came back to life. I don't know. I think I happen to think, I guess, that Steve Bannon is sort of like Trump's Vladislav Surkov.
Mm-hmm.
He's kind of his like dark... Knight, his political chess master.
Some people, and certainly he would think that he got Trump elected.
Yeah.
You know, that he's sort of the media mogul mastermind.
Yeah, it's like sort of a toss-up between him and Roger Stone, who I feel about Roger Stone the way that Dasha feels about Steve Bannon. He's like,
you're obsessed
with him.
I'm obsessed with
him.
You
want to fuck them?
No, not at all.
I might fuck Steve Bannon out of some like dark like death drive sort of wish, you know?
I don't
where you like
know.
Get off on just how disgusting and abject the experience is. But I was truly when Trump first got elected, I spent many weeks like just trying to figure out what was up just with like Steve Bannon.
Looking at photos of
like
his
reading
face.
Article like multiple tabs open, just trying to find out like what because he's truly so crazy.
And nefarious. And yeah. You were explaining...
He's like pure evil.
You were explaining earlier this fourth turn idea.
Yeah, his
that
whole, like, his whole idea, all of his, like, his philosophies are based in this prophecy that he read in some, like, pop sociology book that posits that world events unfold in like cycles of four.
Mm-hmm. So he's a fan of Jordan Peterson.
Probably. I mean, I would assume. Yeah. But that, and that we are in fact due for like a global collapse.
Okay.
Once again.
And so you were saying that he's kind of an active accelerationist and he's like fine with, incurring whatever the human price for that is.
Yeah. He really does worship chaos. Yeah. And wants to see this world burn. And apparently he like manufactures meth in his bathtub as well. Do you guys hear
Wait,
that
what?
Story?
That I'm impressed by. I thought he was doing something far worse, like dissolving hookers in his bathtub and then plastering
them up in the
drywall.
That's
no one really knows what the deal was with the acid in the bathtub, but my guess would be some kind of like
meth.
White nationalist meth. Brewing ring or something.
He looks like he tests the meth.
I cannot understand why he doesn't just even try to have better skin. Like how
has money.
Yeah,
he
like
on
what,
he
can afford to what Glossier. End? Yeah, to what end are you trying to accrue all this power if you still have like rosacea or whatever is wrong with your face?
Yeah, I think he needs to get on one of those like 11-step Korean skincare
regimens.
Some
glycolic pads, Steve Bannon, if you're listening. They're called glycolic pads. And
or
they'll just burn that first layer of skin right off, and then you're going to need to get on a intensive moisturizing regimen and always wear sunscreen as well.
Mm-hmm. So, but I think like one of Trump's more noteworthy flights of genius, if we can I don't know if we can give him credit for this, but is actually like firing all these like architects and puppet masters of his campaign.
Sloppy
from
Steve, that's what Trump calls them.
But actually dismissing them from official positions mm-hmm. within his campaign or his cabinet, and then basically allowing them or empowering them to go through unofficial media channels to go to bat for him. Like, I think it's like, totally strategic mm-hmm. because they get to like basically minimize their mutual liability.
Right.
Yeah. And Bannon, who's founded Breitbart, gets to go back to that, which was his real empire.
Yeah, I mean, I think these people are basically like media masterminds, not political masterminds. Yeah. They're like in the game of optics, not in the game of politics.
Did you guys know he produced Brown Bunny?
What's
the Vincent Gallo movie where Chloe Sevigny
sucks? Bannon did. Oh,
what?
Yeah, because he used to want to be before he started making sort of conspiratory documentaries. He wanted to be like an independent film producer.
Oh my god, I wonder what alternate reality Steve Bannon would have been like.
I know.
Who makes like indie movies.
He went to Sundance, I think, in 2004 and was like laughed at by all of the like
for being
the
ugly.
Beautiful
the
glitterati, people. Yeah.
slash like people didn't even remember seeing mm-hmm. him. He went there to try and like
he got his revenge.
The sales
like, well, he got yeah, he became a political sales. Operative so he could like fuck everybody in the ass.
And just like constantly
on a grand scale.
I'd love to just like have a talk with him. Yeah. Really. I'd love to grab
like
lunch,
coffee. Yeah.
Like whole bottle of white wine and just.
That's funny because that's how I feel like about Roger Stone. And then maybe we could.
Maybe we could do a little double date.
Yeah, totally. And then we can have like kind of a fight because Roger Stone thinks that Audrey Gelman is one of the best dressed women.
Does he?
He loves her style.
That's such a weird position
to
take.
And I think wearing metal tees and having a Dipset tattoo while wearing Manolo Blahniks is like
offensive.
Mega corny.
Offensive.
Yeah. Gucci loafers. Yeah. With
spiritual
fur.
Gangster.
But you know, I think we could agree to disagree. So, but basically, the nature of this interview was Steve Bannon coming out of his like the rafters where he hangs upside down to sing the praises of this zero tolerance policy
and Trump in general,
is
how proud he is of Trump, and then vocalizing his support of this recent zero tolerance immigration policy that has gotten a lot of attention because of how horrifying it is.
Draconian and brutal across mm-hmm. the board.
And Bannon's case that he made, basically, which doesn't even hold up in a rudimentary way, was that these people are criminals.
Oh my
and
God.
And we don't let criminals, we separate children from criminals. It was sort of his.
He's a criminal.
Well, yeah. I mean, it goes without saying. But I was thinking, like, you know, like now let's say hypothetically that these migrants are criminals, which they're very clearly not. What's like the long term strategy here? Like, if their crime is entering the country illegally to escape a far worse fate in their native countries, it seems like a pretty insignificant criminal offense.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, what's the utility of like separating children from non-violent, non-dangerous
right.
mm-hmm. people in the grand scope of things? And you know, you start to realize that like these migrants are only useful as like criminalized wards of the immigration authorities, and their kids are not useful at all except like as political pawns,
mm-hmm.
right,
in kind of the culture wars. But so I guess I was reading up on the zero tolerance policy, and like these separations allegedly, according to The Intercept, have been occurring since 2005 under something called Operation Streamline, which I love how all these operations have completely like kind of like euphemistic.
Yeah.
They're like Slack notes or keynote presentations. But on May 7th, the Attorney General Jeff Sessions announced that the U.S. government would prosecute 100% of these cases.
Even people like who are on the books seeking asylum.
Yes, exactly.
Such a waste of time.
And
such an
this is now bringing a child into the country with you illegally is now has been reframed as quote smuggling of child smuggling.
Your own child.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
so the the parents are basically smugglers. Yeah.
Right. Of course.
And again, according to The Intercept, Sessions' announcement came 2 weeks after an official with the Department of Health and Human Services told Congress that the agency had, quote, lost track of 1,475 unaccompanied migrant children it had placed as sponsors.
That was the initial outrage. Some journalists went into the detention center, which is basically like a converted Walmart where they're housing like 5 children to a room.
That's smart. So they're going to detain them and then put them directly to work as like underpaid like agriculture and retail workers.
And yeah, he detailed
horrors.
The Trump mural,
which are in internment camps.
Yeah,
and it's obviously extremely heartbreaking because being a kid is already so hard
as it is. Yeah,
like you have no control over
you're
anything.
You're so lonely and confused. Then you're ripped away from your parents, which is like the most horrifying thing that can happen to you.
Yeah, I mean, but it just goes to show like how these policies are designed, which is that they're like front loaded for maximum political impact with very little forethought as to how they will play out, like whatever effects
what
and
are they
externalities
going to do
they're
going
to have.
These kids.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean,
have no idea.
Yeah, where do you where do you put them?
Exactly,
I mean, if you
like
misplace,
this is just,
yeah.
It's already like it, my the feeling of it about it is just like, oh God, it's already too late.
Yeah,
like there's actually no way to rectify this. Like, yeah, it's already.
I mean, there are already, if you think about it, thousands of children who are kind of stuck in the United States foster care system. These children presumably will continue to be detained in some unofficial manner until they're no longer minors.
I saw a Breitbart headline that said, children border crossers have higher standard of living than 13 million impoverished American children.
Yeah, that's I saw that,
which I didn't. I couldn't actually bring myself to read it, but it's the point remains that this country just does not give a shit about kids.
Well, yeah,
or what happens to them, American or migrant.
No, and I was thinking about this like in terms of like Breitbart's strategy here.
Like, I'm sure that actually maybe is a little bit true that these kids in internment camps do have a higher standard of living.
Right. I was thinking like, well, that's a pretty low bar to set for American children. It's like, again, in true American fashion, we have extremely exacting standards for everything but the professions that matter, like teachers, police officers, immigration authorities,
social workers,
basically everybody who's tasked with like protecting the populace is in some sense implicated in like terrorizing and violating them. That's like a horrible, like Breitbart is basically acknowledging that the conditions for American kids are shitty enough as it is.
We should just let them into the country in that case.
Yeah.
Maybe we can ship the American kids to Latin America in exchange, like in some
exchange program.
But they're basically, I mean, I feel like what's going on here is a situation where like these kind of media puppet masters like Trump and Bannon are leveraging a basically captive population in kind of against a warring set of media optics.
Yeah, like Trump's whole spiel is that it's the Democrats' fault.
Right.
Somehow.
Yeah.
I was like, I wasn't exactly able to parse out why that was.
And like, and to help them with this, they basically have the assistance of like hard-boiled, like concentration camp style bureaucratic enforcers like Jeff Sessions, who are less interested in the entertainment or media angle and sort of just relish in
Jeff Sessions literally quoting scripture to justify obeying
draconian
laws. Yeah, like out of your goddamn mind.
And it's like, I mean, but he's kind of like a perfect poster child for like the banality of evil or whatever, like famous like Arendt thing. But they're, I mean, all of these sort of policies are just basically calibrated to like inflame the country's racial animus along the established fault lines of like Republican and Democrat, whatever, liberal and conservative. Like at the expense of these displaced people whose lives are literally being gambled with.
Mm-hmm. And people call us fascists on
the
internet.
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah, you guys.
And
like we're
You're the
actually
fascist.
Inhabiting a neo-fascist
state. Yeah.
State.
But so I was reading up on this, and I guess in May, the total number of children who were separated from their parents and which were acknowledged by the U.S. government officially was 1,358.
Jesus.
Yeah. And that's like enough to fill a pretty large sized high school. And
yeah, like a very large high school.
So by now, that number has probably grown. What we're looking at now is like 2,000 or more cases of children who have been already separated from their parents. And of course, the data is like very spotty and scant. But the other thing right. is that not only is this program going on like unabated, but it's also basically the rate of separation is growing.
Yeah.
So it's like kind of a snowball effect. And there's this guy, Lee Gellernt, who's a lawyer who's bringing the suit against this mm-hmm. practice against through the ACLU. And he talks about how like the total reflects the emerging scale of a practice that will have lasting impact on a generation of kids who happen to arrive in the U.S. at this particular moment. I mean,
it's
this is
already
like,
too late.
Yeah, exactly. And like, there's no...
Think about the traumas people encounter just over the course of a normal childhood that yeah. scar them indefinitely and make them, like, worse citizens.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And, of course, you know, leave it to, like, Bannon and Breitbart to kind of reframe this, to see the silver lining in this yeah. like, completely, like, atrocious, draconian thing.
Is that the converted Walmart...
Yeah.
Child prison is actually pretty nice compared to the living conditions.
Yeah.
Of to the way that we live American in Bushwick, children.
Yeah.
I was like, ooh, towels. Yeah. Like, they have towels.
Wow, they have towels.
You know, I would be
jealous.
I would be like happy to take some of these kids in myself, but they would see how I live and immediately flee.
They're not gonna like it.
Yeah, they're not gonna like it. Yeah. Yeah, we're gonna move from children being ripped from the hands of their parents to local hype beasts LARPing as parents.
There we go.
Yeah.
Whoop, whoop. Dad core, ladies and gentlemen.
Mac DeMarco.
Yeah.
You may have noticed a new trend amongst young coastal elites, mm-hmm. such as ourselves, where some of the fuckboys are starting to look more and more like dad.
Our fuck dads.
Like our fuck dads. Dad.
I have to say that as far as like dad core is concerned, which is like... in my mind, this is like just a really contextualized or directional evolution of normcore, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's like an elevated normcore with
more
like
specific.
An extra conceptual
yeah.
bend.
Yeah.
That's a little more specific, a little more gendered.
Mm-hmm.
The New York Times wrote an article.
Of course they did.
Of yeah. course. What else would they
what
do?
What else is there to talk yeah. about other than
certainly
dadcore.
Nothing. But since it is our Father's Day episode and since we are... you know, a cultural commentary podcast. No one's yeah. really tuning in for our takes on immigration policy.
Our political analysis, yeah, our hard-hitting political analysis. Though I will say our political analysis does trump that of, you know, Trevor Noah and John Oliver. I'm going to put that
yeah.
out there on record. But naturally, I noticed that in this New York Times article, of course, they quoted Emily Siegel, who... was originally the founder of K-Hole, which
yeah.
is a
who
kind
coined
of
coined normcore.
Yeah, she mm-hmm. she I guess the K-Hole, which is like basically a
trend forecasting agency.
Forecasting PDF puppy mill consulting neoliberal gobbledygook.
Cognoscenti.
Yeah. And now is part of something called Nemesis Global, which is being billed as a
Whoa.
Quote a think tank. Which is like big LOL, but I'm gonna play nice today. but so anyway, basically, she was quoted as saying that in her own words, the point isn't that dadcore is so much as like LARPing as a father as it is about being self-consciously unsexy.
Mm-hmm. Which is astute.
Yeah.
You disagree.
I think that that's the look that we're all going for lately, self-consciously unsexy.
Yeah.
Or like kind of so unsexy that it's actually kind of abject and sexy.
Which is what sexuality
yeah.
is.
It really is, yeah.
About.
When you don't care, you're the hottest.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. But I do find it kind of deliciously ironic that dadcore is making a splash at a moment when like calls to crush the patriarchy are at their most loudest. Right. Yeah.
Like perhaps it's actually tapping into some nostalgia we have before, like the dad as an archetype was
destroyed. Demoted
to, yeah.
Dadcore is basically like the Handmaid's Tale for men.
Before dads were canceled.
Before dads were canceled.
And they were a more like benign, unfashionable force in our lives.
Yeah, exactly.
So like what's like a look of a dadcore person?
I think the number one kind of
cargo
avatar practitioner of dadcore is our very own Adam Friedland.
Adam Friedland does
like in the other room.
Yeah.
What's he wearing now?
He's wearing some baggy Patagonia shorts and a Planet Fitness t-shirt.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he's barefoot, but if he had shoes on, they would be some kind of like
Crocs,
perhaps Crocs, which he does wear around the house, or he has like New Balances or Asics or something, or the Balenciaga
sort of
shoe,
the shoe, the orthopedic,
God, the riff shoe on the that orthopedic tore the shoe. World apart.
Well, so I mean, I think this whole aesthetic right now is basically coming out because nobody can afford having a kid, and nobody can afford investing their money in things that matter, because they like, you know, for example, like saving for your future, buying a house,
it's not happening
because they're most of their precarity wages are being channeled directly into rent, and then the other fraction they blow on like nose beers or Balenciaga sneakers. I mean, like that's what we're all doing.
I mean, it's also easy to look like shit. There was someone wrote an article about Anna Delvey sort of in this vein, which is that rather than trying to LARP as a rich person by wearing like expensive, nice clothes, you kind of dress down and you dress shitty and you wear like athleisure.
Yeah.
Because that's the true mark of an elite, is that they don't actually care.
They're not trying to like show off.
Yeah. And if I am going to like a nice department store or something, or I'm on one of my like shoplifting excursions, I will put on usually like a really like a threadbare ripped t-shirt.
Exactly.
That hangs Britney Spears so
at the gas station.
Probably.
So that I look more believably rich that way than I would if I put on like the most expensive things I owned.
I mean, listen, this is the most revealing and confessional I'm ever going to get on this podcast, but I once had sex with a person who was like a member of I've had sex like once with this guy who was like literally a European count, and when he walked into the room he looked literally homeless. He had like alabaster
account.
I googled him, I have the receipts.
Okay.
He had alabaster skin and you know gorgeous tussled hair, and was wearing
inbred, was
like all homeless people.
And was wearing a
homeless people are very tan.
No, he was very pale. He was like a living under a bridge.
But
he was wearing this sweater that I immediately pegged as cashmere. I immediately pegged him. being like, you know, a brand whore or like a fashion victim. I was like, that's a cashmere sweater, but it was like completely like nubby and like pilling and covered in holes. And the one thing that gave away the fact that he was like sort of rich was he had a monogram on the sweater. And was wearing like, you know, like run down, like boring, dumpy slacks and run down New Balance sneakers. But the thing that was like sort of remarkable for me about this trend wasn't like the specific nature of the trend. It's that this is a trend that like directly affects straight men. And like in the past, I mean, we all know that women and gays are susceptible to fashion trends. But
of course.
Now
but yeah,
we're talking
gay guys aren't really doing
dadcore as much.
Are they?
I feel like they might a little bit.
Well,
my friend Mike was wearing a nice, like, a little oversized gingham shirt the other day.
Yeah, I think friends of the pod, Dan Allegretto and Oliver Cano, have been known to dabble in the dadcore. But this was before this was even a trend. But now, like, straight men are sort of cultivating a heretofore unheard of level of aesthetic connoisseurship.
Yeah.
Which I, you know, is significant sociologically speaking, whether or not you think gender or sexual preference or whatever are socially constructed.
Sure.
It's like a new thing. But in my mind, I'm like really all for anything like any trend that makes men look more like men, I'm into it. Cause it's like so tiresome living.
Yeah.
I like it.
I agree.
I just, yeah, I like when people aren't trying to look fancy.
Yeah.
It's just hot.
Yeah. Tired. It's so tiresome.
It's so boring. It's like exhausting.
Yes. To live in Brooklyn where all the men have tiny backpacks and tiny shoes and tiny glasses and stick and poke tattoos. And like,
I know every single one of them.
I like a man who's no frills, like who looks like a gym teacher or a firefighter. Like I like a man who looks like he might yell at you in public.
My ex-boyfriend wore,
I think you nailed it.
Like Kohl's t-shirts that his brother gave him and like cargo shorts and like the cheapest like Asics.
Adam is a big,
shoes. I loved it.
Yeah. Adam is a big Kirkland. He's a Kirkland
brand
boy.
Is like the best brand.
Solid.
Kirkland brand makes me wet.
For sure.
I like cargo shorts, some wraparound Oakleys, no. Like maybe like a bucket hat or like a
Wow, that's a look.
One of those, what do you call it? Like portable pocket fans.
I love those.
Yeah, camel pack.
Camel pack.
I saw a guy throwing up on the train with a camel pack on the other day.
He was probably drinking alcohol out of it.
He looked fit. He seemed maybe like he had like
what's a camel pack?
It's a backpack that with straws that go in your mouth that you can.
Wow. There's like a layer of like water.
That is a new trend
for
after
when
fanny
for like
packs.
Endurance hikers.
Snowboard always had them.
Do you know? Do you guys notice that everybody's doing this trend that's like a fanny pack thrown over the shoulder effortlessly? Mm-hmm.
I saw that in Berlin.
Supreme
last summer. That was everyone.
Yeah, I think like Berlin is like the petri dish for
try some stuff out.
That's where the viral.
Yeah, for all these like the virus bag begins. Trends. Yeah, I'm glad like the tiny bangs bowl haircut thing hasn't gotten big in New York because God knows the men don't need any help at being uglier. But I had this tweet recently that basically said like too much physical affectation is a sign of a weak moral constitution.
Yes.
And like, you know, all these like woke retards piled on and were like, this is a homophobic tweet. And of course I wasn't talking about homosexuals because women and gays have a purchase on physical affectation. It's
That's
what we
their
do.
Domain.
Yeah.
It's
exactly.
our domain. Yeah. But it's in my mind.
No, and to read that immediately associate physical affectation with gays is itself homophobic.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
how it is, though.
Yeah. But in my mind, like,
they do be like that.
But, like, in my mind, like, it's absolutely unacceptable for a straight man to be, like, overly physically affected. You have to be, like, unassuming and nondescript so that when you break into my house to enact our mutual rape fantasy, enact our mutual rape fantasy.
I like a man in a ball
of I don't know
lava.
What's coming. Yeah.
Yeah.
My last serious boyfriend had no... very sparse furniture and nothing on his walls in his apartment. It was just a white studio apartment with a white sheets. And that was probably a big motivator to start a relationship with him because there was no red flags.
Yeah.
Like really
that,
as
I mean,
a man, you're
one
just trying.
I mean, that's a different kind of red. It's a white. Yeah.
you're like, this guy lives like Patrick Bateman. Maybe he'll be the one to sex murder.
Yeah.
Daddy.
This guy's chill.
It was more charming than that. It was kind of like, you know, bare bones, like a writer, you know, like he doesn't have time to decorate his home because he's too busy having
brooding.
Like brilliant thoughts or whatever.
Oh, I get that.
You know,
he's like too busy pretending.
Whereas if you walk into a man's house and it's like very decorated, there's
over-accessorized.
Yeah, over-accessorized. There's all these ways that things can go wrong.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
like you might break one of his expensive home decor accessories and he'll like invoice you.
Yeah.
But we do, I think that we really do have like Balenciaga to blame for this. Like they accessorized the models on their spring summer, like men's runway show with literal children.
Right.
I think like, I will say like my polemic, I have a whole Balenciaga Vet Mons polemic, if you guys will indulge me, but I think that they're really kind of like, they are the kind of tastemakers of peak neoliberal aesthetics. this is something that my friend Antonio, who I'm writing a piece on this mm-hmm. supposedly with, always says, is that rather than selling like an aesthetic or even a lifestyle, what they're doing is selling a framework that sort of like omnivorously, like gluttonously absorbs everything in its path and makes it like primed for commodification. Like
the framework being
like any reference you can name. If Balenciaga and before that Vetements got its hands on it, uh-huh. like, you know, they did like the babushka scarves, they right. did the clogs right. with the charms, like anything plucked from like this kind of like mm-hmm. very boring, mundane, working class milieu suddenly becomes like a high fashion object. Mm-hmm. And it really doesn't matter what the object is anymore. Like before in fashion, it mattered a little bit.
Yeah.
Like what the specific, you know, trend or whatever aesthetic was. But I think that it's like a total, this is not a mean polemic. I think it's a really brilliant, like given the circumstances, brilliant strategy, you know, yeah. overall.
I think we've all been excited to see how Balenciaga has developed.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about that, but
But
all you get basically are these like totally like free floating signifiers that are unmoored from any uh-huh. previous reference, and like it's almost like, you know, it's like not even nostalgia for a specific time or place. And they've been accused of like kind of like breaking out this kind of like working class, like,
well, yeah, they make
Eastern Bloc aesthetic.
I appreciate it because they're things that look like knockoffs are extremely easy to get actual knockoffs.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
And then they bear a striking resemblance to the original.
Yeah, but that's the point. There's not yeah. like previously I feel like fashion houses were very protective of their wares. Like uh-huh. Balenciaga doesn't give a fuck.
No.
No.
But it's not like nostalgia for like a specific time or place. It's like nostalgia for nostalgia's sake yeah. at this mm-hmm. point. And that's sort of what dadcore is, because it's not, I don't know that it's nostalgia for like fatherhood even, or
no. No, I don't think it goes that deep.
Yeah.
No.
I don't think it's like that.
Who wants to have kids? But the question that I have is that, like, back to this whole like consciously unsexy aesthetic, like why is that such a thing now with like young millennials, like trend setting millennials?
To look like shit?
Yeah.
Because they feel like shit. I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point, actually, that it's like...
That's a good point, yeah. I thought it was like some deeper... Like, I'm always like scrambling for some deeper sociological analysis. I showed up to like dinner with my mom last night, and she was like, "You look like a whore. Cut that disgusting hair." She was
like screaming at me. Your little rat tail?
Yeah, she told me to cut my rat tail.
You look cute like in shit. That dress is very darling.
Thank you.
And you're like...
But then I realized, I was like, have I become, because like this is like what people on Reddit will always say, there, have I become a victim of irony poisoning? Do I look like shit and not know it?
No.
I mean, no, I don't. But you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Are we all adopting like certain, like, are we doing something wrong by refusing to be basic?
I think my style is very like romantic.
Yeah.
I don't try to look like shit.
Yeah.
Maybe I do, but I have like a very like costumey mm-hmm. way of dressing.
Yeah.
That's, it's like rococo. Also ironic. Yeah. Rococo slob.
Yeah.
Is kind of the trend forecast that I'm predicting.
Yeah.
For SS 2018.
Yeah.
But speaking of ineffective men, David Ehrlich, no one cares about this but me because I'm maybe the only like film Twitter adjacent person, but David Ehrlich, who writes for IndieWire, penned a similar article about something he deemed nicecore, which is sort of a cinematic response to the sinister root, like, rudeness of the Trump administration, which he posits as evidenced by Paddington 2, a children's movie,
which are always positive.
The Mr. Rogers documentary, which is one of his favorite movies, super annoyingly. The Mr. Rogers documentary and a movie called Heartbeats Loud, where Nick Offerman seems like plays guitar with his biracial daughter as these sort of like feel good films that are indicative of some sort of shift. In a very flimsy argument.
There's like so many other movies being made that aren't.
Yeah. That reveals like a real lack of any sense of zeitgeist or anything.
Have you seen though, this Mr. Rogers documentary?
Meg saw it in Maryland, but,
he's like kind of the original like dad of all dads to like Trump all dads, but
he's
like
everyone's
so,
dad.
So Nice Court is, so he's, this guy is like positing some sort of shift where because of the nastiness of Trump's politics and
that we all need, that people maybe want to go to the movies to get a little break
to escape. Yeah.
From all the bad news.
This sounds like what they said about the Nazis. Like when, when
Paddington 1 came out.
Yeah. Yeah. Paddington versus the Luftwaffe.
You saw Paddington too, Lynn.
I did.
Did it make you feel good?
Not really. I mean,
I'm more of a Zootopia kind of girl.
I didn't see Paddington 1, but I read it on Wikipedia. I watched it on Wikipedia, and it is one of the most horrifying stories I've ever heard. Like, all the bears die. It's like, he gets like, yeah, no, it's like, it's so sad. But the second one, he goes to jail and then makes it like a Wes Anderson jail.
I can't wait until Paddington is outed as a pedophile.
I know.
Until he gets Me Too.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Like another ineffective man in the news.
Yeah, yeah. I was just thinking, speaking of nice guys. Anyway.
Speaking of Nice Corps.
Nice guys.
Nerds.
Nerds.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, Chris Hardwick has fallen under fire this week after his ex-girlfriend wrote a Medium post detailing, and she didn't name him. She's mentioned several times that she doesn't want, she didn't even like public boost the post herself, but the internet being what it is, obviously it disseminated
very quickly. You don't
write
something
quickly
on Medium about that. And
yeah. But her angle is sort of like, I'm just warning other women about
the dynamics
that are present in abusive relationships.
Yeah, yeah. She said, I'm warning people about emotionally abusive relationships, and I'm also kind of seeking closure. First of all, when I heard of this, I was like, isn't Chris Hardwick the guy who hosted that dating show on MTV with Jenny McCarthy and then Carmen Electra? Like the singled out show? That's him, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And which now, I did not know about and did not know who he was.
I used to watch that show, which reveals how old I am, but... mainly for Carmen Electra because I'm a raging lesbian for Naomi Russell and Carmen Electra. But I was like, how did he rebrand as a nerd? Because he was kind of like a cool guy back then for hosting this like show.
Nerdist was sort of his empire.
Nerdist. I like retch at the thought of that.
A fellow podcaster has fallen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh,
but
no.
the other thing that's like, I was like in principle, I am down for anything that actively kind of takes down nerd culture because I think self-identified nerds are
violence.
The literal worst, most insufferable people.
Entitled beyond.
Who for some reason think they have a moral high ground.
Yeah. And like,
yeah, because they like Star Wars, obviously.
Well, yeah, but here's the thing.
Because they're the ultimate consumers.
Yes, yeah, yeah. And it's
so
like
backwards.
nine and a half times, 9.8 times out of 10, these people aren't even smart, even though like the number one qualifying criteria for a nerd is like being actually smart.
That's like the idea. That's the association that people have.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So they think if they like certain things, it makes them smart.
It's like the commodification of smart. It reminds me of that meme that was going around like 4 years ago of like that bespectacled talk today. Hot girl. Where it was like, calm down, you're not a nerd, you're just a whore who found glasses. And like, remember like, what is this, like 5 years ago, you had this like outcropping of like intellectual porn stars like Sasha Gray and Stoya, and they were like...
Charlotte Sartre.
Yeah, yeah. They were like, I've read Foucault, but I also like to take it up the ass. And everybody was like...
I'll also do a blow bang.
Yeah.
4 days a week.
And they're like, I can pop this golf ball out of my butthole, but I've read some critical theory. Yeah. But the fetish there was that they were intellectual, not hot.
They're not like the other girls. They're not like the other porn stars.
And like back in the day, I think back in the day, being a nerd was, or being smart was frowned upon by cool people because it prevented, it thwarted you from doing badass shit like having sex and doing drugs.
Right.
And now being a nerd is cool. And it's why I think
their reign has gone on too long.
Yeah. Well, I think it's because nerd is just another way, a euphemistic way of saying liberal. And now that, I mean, it really is.
Kind of true.
Now, like a cultural liberal, like the sort of person who watches Glee or Big Bang Theory or
Rick and Morty.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't even know anything about Rick and Morty, but like.
I don't watch cartoons.
Yeah.
I've seen it. It's like funny, but it's like, I don't.
Well, their audience has ruined it.
Their audience so like ruins
no
everything.
There's no way I will ever.
Yeah, I have no interest.
Begin to watch Rick
and having
this
anything
is like
in common
what's
with
going to happen to our podcast. So I guess we can sympathize with Rick and
with
Morty.
With Rick and Morty. Sure.
But like, I think like now that liberalism has been gone from being like the underdog into the mainstream, the mores and values of these like sexless, professionalized middle class prudes and bores have like proliferated the culture.
Nerds also big proponents of polyamory.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And various other like sexual games.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's
the
like
gamification
people,
of sexuality.
Yeah, it's like people who call sex play. But the trick, I think the trick, the reason that they call themselves nerds is because they're now firmly in the mainstream, but their identity depends. They derive their whole identity from still identifying as an underdog. Like they can't accept that they're
The mainstream. Like,
this is it.
The top player now.
Yeah.
Like, this is what culture is now. It's like Deadpool.
Ugh,
like
God.
I want Elon Musk to suffer so much.
Yeah. Did you guys see this, like, really annoying, corny Twitter account that everybody's retweeting?
Oh, it's the
like
Italian. It's not funny.
It's like, Mamma Mia, I put a pasta into space.
That person owes NYC Guido voice royalties.
Oh, that one's
in
funny.
My opinion.
Oh, no, I actually just tweeted this on the car here that it's like a less funny NYC Guido voice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
NYC Guido voice is the only
That
Italian parody account that Red Scare endorses.
But, yeah, true. Yeah. It's the only.
That one's good, though.
Yeah.
I mean,
great.
Nick Mullen.
Yeah.
Sorry, not to dox him, but.
I guess we should talk about some of the sexual...
The harrowing details.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
sure.
The harrowing details, the sexual dimensions. I mean, Dasha, did you read the Medium post?
Yeah.
Okay.
Of course I did. She also talks about being really anorexic over the span of their relationship. Him not letting her talk to him in public because he was convinced people were listening.
Yeah.
And so they would go out to dinner and he would silently like look at his phone, which sounds like a lot of dinners I've had with Adam, but I'll save that for the Medium post.
Yeah. When you meet to Adam.
Anyway, she got an endopic pregnancy. Which she seemed to link to her anorexia. And when she was recovering from surgery, like invasive surgery in the hospital, Chris Hardwick and her mother were there, and when the doctor informed them that she was going to be okay, the first question he asked was, when can I have sex with her next? And she says her mother never forgot.
I mean, this guy for sure sounds very emotionally abusive and controlling in that like particularly like brittle, punitive way of a man who's insecure with his own stature in life and his own like masculinity, but like none of this is a crime and none of this should be legislated.
Well, she also says that he would make her wait for him she says that he sexually assaulted her over.
Yeah, that's really the problematic detail. There's two details here that are truly, truly problematic if they are true, which is that he conceivably sexually assaulted her and also the idea that afterward he tried to get her blacklisted from finding work in the industry. Yeah. Those are like maybe quasi-criminal scenarios. But in my mind, like, you know, it's like, I think this woman dodged a bullet.
Absolutely.
I hope she gets help for her trauma.
She seems
and
better
I wish
now.
Her the best.
His new wife's...
is Lydia Hearst.
Yeah. Whoa.
Who is that?
He has a type. He likes the redheads.
He likes those waifish redheads for sure.
I love the part where she writes, the first time I told him I loved him after 6 months of hoping he'd say at first, his response was, and I quote, "I think I love you too, faggot."
I thought it was fuck it.
It's one word.
That it starts with an A and ends with a T and has asterisks in the middle.
Yes. I was like, if it is indeed faggot,
I don't think it is. That makes no sense.
It doesn't make any sense, but what else could it be?
I thought it was, I know it's one word, but I thought it was fuck it because it makes more sense.
Why can't we fuck it? I want to know what the word is.
Yeah, wait. Because if it's.
I will say this.
If he said the hard F.
Here's the thing. If he said, I love you, I think I love you too, fuck it. That means nothing. That's just like him. That's just like a guy telling you he's normal.
Well, that's just rude.
If he said, I mean, it's not even rude. It's just like, fuck it.
I'd be like, okay.
If he said faggot, that's not abusive either. That just means he was like ashamed and embarrassed of his own feelings.
And also was trying to.
It barely makes sense.
It doesn't make sense.
It makes zero
sense. But it's like in the most generous reading, it sounds like he was like trying to power through his own emotional discomfort by making light of it. I don't know. But like.
So bizarre.
And the other thing that I thought that was super crazy was that one of the images the only image I think that she includes in the post is a picture of her anorexia progress in quotes, which she identifies as like being unhealthy and bad. But it's like, wait, you're writing a post about how a man systematically emotionally abused you, alienated you from your friends, and drove you into an eating disorder, and the picture that you choose is like a sexy waifish picture of yourself. Yeah. That's so weird.
Yeah.
The long-lasting effects of having an eating disorder.
I think
though.
It's weird.
Like, right. That's true. Yeah. You still
have like those tendencies, right? Like,
sure, we all have eating disorders.
You want people to see how concerningly you are.
No, I get that. I have the same tendencies, please. I'm like, literally, I eat like one meal a day now because I'm trying to be skinny. But like, for the love of God, that's not the picture that I would include in my Me Too Medium post. She just putting that out there. That I'm going to get thin. In trouble for this, aren't I, God?
Whatever. No, I don't think you will.
But I think it's like, she's a little bit maybe confused with that, and I'm not sure what, like, you know, she says she wants closure. I'm not sure what closure means, because this man was literally, you know, I have no love lost for Chris Hardwick. I literally didn't remember he existed until last week.
Didn't even know who he was. Yeah. But,
I unfortunately was aware of him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really care in the long run, but ultimately, like, there was no formal inquiry, no court procedure.
Yeah, and I mean, that's not, no, you don't
job over a Medium post. That's weird.
I mean, that's how it's been going. That's how it is. That's
everyone's losing their job.
That's the new court of public opinion that we're in. That's the Me Too moment.
But yeah, I mean, I guess.
I'm not going to, like, Chris Hardwick's not going to be the one I'm going to
cry over. No, I mean, yeah. I don't really care either.
Nah,
but
he can
like,
fuck off.
God damn it, what was I going to say? But the other guy that recently got Me Too'd was the owner of the Bunny Ranch, which I kind of chortled
to.
Oh,
really?
Like, this guy literally owns a brothel. Like, what did
that's
you expect? Yeah,
what did he job? Get Me Too'd for?
I have no idea. I didn't read into it because I was
I had no idea about this.
Yeah. But that's like, you know, that's a little
mad. I mean, if your workplace is a brothel.
Yeah.
I think there's going to be some blurry lines.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I will say, okay, like the details of this particular story aside, I think it does shed some light on a very important thing, which is that these kind of nerdy dudes who are like nice guys finish last are often like classic aggressors masquerading as victims. They're not so great in the end.
Definitely not.
They're kind of bad guys.
Even worse. Yeah. Should be ostracized from society and not allowed to interact with women, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. Which is why I say ladies.
See, look at what happens when you let them get a girlfriend.
Yeah.
She gets too skinny.
Maybe I need to date one of those guys.
Oh, God, no, please.
Shut up, Anna.
No, but, you know, ladies.
Literally, this couldn't happen. Like, wouldn't happen to you.
No, I mean, it literally.
They're insufferable. Like, those types of men are truly insufferable. I would not let them in our house.
What, nerds?
Yeah, like if you brought a nerd back, I would
leave. No, what I'm saying, though, is like, you know, ladies, if a man with a particular liking of admiration for Star Wars takes a liking to, run for the hills. You are better off going for the guy in the wife beater with like a giant keychain with like 50 keys.
A landlord.
Yeah, a landlord. Yeah.
A super.
Yeah. Landlord core.
Oh.
trend forecast. Yeah. Hot trend forecast here.
Superintendent core. Next,
trend is going to be looking like a janitor.
Actually, I mean, Dickie's...
Carhartt.
Yeah.
That's the jumpsuits. Nerds are out.
Find you a nice guy who looks like he'll yell at you in public.
Yeah. Or a dad core guy.
A nice dad core guy who's emotionally withholding. Maybe owns a few too many sneakers.
Mm-hmm. I'm really excited that the backlash against twee masculinity is finally beginning.
Likewise.
Yeah.
Well,
that's it for us.
Remarks? No. Mm. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day. Love all of you daddies.
See you now.
See you now.